गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, माय सेल्फ डॉक्टर उषा दांडेकर, प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एनाटॉमी. टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विथ द अपर लिम एंड द टॉपिक फॉर टुडे सेशन इज पेक्टोरल रीजन एंड मेमोरी ग्लैंड. नाउ पेक्टोरल रीजन, इट लाइज ऑन द फ्रंट ऑफ द चेस्ट. नाउ इन दिस पिक्चर, दिस इज द पेक्टोरल रीजन which lies on the front of the chest, and it is that part of the body which connects the upper limb to the chest. So it is a connecting part between the upper limb and the chest. Before dealing with the pectoral region, let us see the surface landmarks of the pectoral region. Now this is the clavicle. Clavicle is a bone. It is a modified bone, modified long bone. So this is the clavicle. Now between these two clavicles, there is a depressed area. This area is called as jugular notch. Then 5 centimeters below the jugular notch, there is sternal angle. Now sternal angle, it represents the junction between the manubrium and the body of the sternum. So it is a joint, basically it is a joint, that is the manubriosternal joint, which lies 5 centimeters below the jugular notch. And this manubriosternal joint is called as sternal angle. And at the level of the sternal angle, you can feel the second rib. Okay, so the sternal angle, it is a landmark for the second rib. Now, inferior to the sternum, just below the sternum, there is another depressed area that is called as the epigastric fossa. Then just below the clavicle, lateral part of the clavicle, there is a depression, and this depression is called as the infraclavicular fossa. So here you can clearly see the infraclavicular fossa, which lies below the clavicle. And if you palpate this fossa, you will get the tip of the coracoid process. Coracoid process is a part of the scapula. So tip of the coracoid process can be felt in the infraclavicular fossa. And lastly, the acromion process, which is also a part of scapula, it forms the top of the shoulder. So at the top of the shoulder, there is acromion process. Now let us begin with the pectoral region. Now this pectoral region, I have already told that the pectoral region lies on the front of the chest, and this pectoral region is covered by skin. Deep to the skin, there is superficial fascia. And the superficial fascia contains fat, cutaneous nerves, cutaneous vessels, then platysma muscle, and one gland, that is the mammary gland. So superficial fascia contains fat, cutaneous nerves, cutaneous vessels, platysma muscle, and mammary gland. So mammary gland is a content of superficial fascia of the pectoral region. Deep to the superficial fascia, so deep to the mammary gland, you will get the deep fascia, and this deep fascia is called as pectoral fascia. And deep to the pectoral fascia, you will get the pectoral muscles. So if you dissect the pectoral region layer by layer, first there is a skin. After reflecting the skin, you will get superficial fascia. In the superficial fascia, there are fat, cutaneous nerves, cutaneous vessels, platysma muscle, and mammary gland. Deep to this superficial fascia, you will get deep fascia. And after reflecting the deep fascia, you will get the pectoral muscles. So today we are going to concentrate on the mammary gland and the pectoral muscles. So the objectives of today's session is to describe the muscles of pectoral region and to describe the mammary gland, and lastly the applied anatomy. Now, which are the muscles of the pectoral region? There are three muscles, the pectoralis major, pectoralis minor, and subclavius. Now, pectoralis major, it is the largest muscle on the pectoral region. Now, here you can see the pectoralis major muscle. Now, whenever you describe any muscle, you have to describe the muscle in four parts. That is the origin of the muscle, insertion of the muscle, nerve supply, and actions of the muscle. So the pectoralis major muscle, it arises from many regions, various regions. So it arises from clavicle, then sternum, costocartilages, and the aponeurosis. So the origin of the pectoralis major is the clavicle, the anterior surface of the clavicle, medial two-third. Clavicle is divided into medial two-third and lateral one-third. So anterior surface of the clavicle, medial two-third part is the clavicular fibers. Then the sternal fibers arise from the anterior surface of the manubrium and the body of the sternum up to sixth costal cartilage. Then costal fibers arise from the costal cartilages up to sixth costal cartilages, and aponeurotic fibers arise from the aponeurosis of external oblique muscle. So pectoralis major arises from many heads, that is the clavicular fibers, sternocostal fibers, and aponeurotic fibers. So clavicular fibers arise from the medial two-third of the anterior surface of the clavicle. Sternal fibers arise from the anterior surface of the manubrium and the body of the sternum laterally. Costal fibers arise from the costal cartilages, from second to sixth costal cartilages, and aponeurotic fibers arise from the aponeurosis of external oblique muscle. External oblique muscle is the muscle of abdomen. Now all these fibers, they converge laterally and they get inserted on the humerus. Now on the humerus, on the anterior surface of the humerus, there is a groove which is called as bicipital groove. And this bicipital groove has two lips, lateral lip and medial lip. So pectoralis major muscle gets inserted on the lateral lip of the bicipital groove in an inverted U-shaped manner. Okay. So this, all these fibers, they converge laterally, and these fibers, they get inserted on the lateral lip of bicipital groove in an U-shaped manner, and the nerve supply, it is supplied by medial pectoral nerve and lateral pectoral nerve. Pectoralis major muscle is supplied by two nerves, the medial pectoral nerve and lateral pectoral nerve. And the actions, if you see the actions of the muscle, so this pectoralis major muscle acting as a whole helps in adduction and medial rotation of the arm. Then clavicular fibers causes flexion of the arm, while the sternocostal fibers help in climbing. Okay, so acting as a whole, this muscle helps in adduction and medial rotation of the arm. Clavicular fibers helps in flexion of the arm, while the sternocostal fibers help in climbing. So therefore, this muscle is also called as climber muscle. The next muscle is the pectoralis minor muscle, which lies deep to the pectoralis major muscle. Now, pectoralis minor muscle arises from third, fourth, and fifth ribs close to the sternocostal, close to the costochondral joint. So the pectoralis minor muscle arises from the third, fourth and fifth ribs close to the costochondral joints. Now this muscle converge laterally and get inserted on the coracoid process. Now this muscle gets inserted on the medial border and upper surface of the coracoid process. It is also supplied by medial and lateral pectoral nerves, and actions of the pectoralis minor are this muscle causes protraction of the scapula. Protraction means it draws the scapula forward. So the pectoralis minor muscle causes protraction of the scapula. Then it depresses the point of the shoulder because it is inserted on the coracoid process. So it depresses the point of the shoulder and it also helps in forced inspiration. So that is the action of pectoralis minor muscle. The next muscle is subclavius. This is the subclavius. It is very small muscle. The subclavius muscle arises from the first rib. This is the first rib and it arises from the first rib close to the costochondral junction, costochondral joint. Okay, so the subclavius muscle arises from the first rib close to the costochondral joint and it is inserted on the inferior surface of the clavicle. On the inferior surface of the clavicle, there is a groove which is called as subclavian groove, and this subclavius muscle gets inserted on the subclavian groove which lies on the inferior surface of the clavicle. This subclavius is supplied by the nerve to subclavius. The nerve to subclavius is a branch of upper trunk of the brachial plexus. And what is the action? The subclavius muscle steadies the clavicle during the movements of the shoulder. So it helps in steadiness of the clavicle. So the pectoral region consists of three muscles, the pectoralis major. Deep to the pectoralis major, there is pectoralis minor and very small muscle called as the subclavius muscle. The next topic is the mammary gland. The mammary gland is an accessory organ of female reproductive system. It is modified sweat gland and it is found in both sexes, but it is well developed in females but rudimentary in males. Now this mammary gland is hemispherical in shape, and where it is situated? It is situated in the superficial fascia of the pectoral region. We have already seen that the superficial fascia of the pectoral region consists of fat, cutaneous nerves, cutaneous vessels, platysma muscle and the mammary gland. So mammary gland lies in the superficial fascia of the pectoral region. This mammary gland is divided into four quadrants: the upper lateral quadrant, upper medial quadrant, lower lateral quadrant and lower medial quadrant. So the gland is divided into four quadrants, and from the upper lateral quadrant there is a small extension. This extension is called as axillary tail of Spence. So from this quadrant, from the upper lateral quadrant, there is a small extension which extends towards the axilla, and this extension is called as axillary tail of Spence. Now the mammary gland extends vertically. It extends from 2nd to 6th ribs, and horizontally It extends from the lateral border of the sternum. This is the sternum. So it extends from the lateral border of the sternum to the mid axillary line. So vertically it extends from 2nd to 6th ribs, and horizontally it extends from the lateral border of the sternum to the mid axillary line. Now what are the parts of mammary gland? It has a base, then apex and axillary tail of Spence. Now this is the base, and this base, it lies on the loose areolar tissue. This is the loose areolar tissue. Deep to the loose areolar tissue, there is pectoral fascia. The green color is the pectoral fascia, and deep to the pectoral fascia, there are pectoral muscles. Pectoralis major muscle, pectoralis minor. Then there are other muscles like serratus anterior, external oblique muscles. So the mammary gland rests on the structures, that is the loose areolar tissue, pectoral fascia, pectoralis major, pectoralis minor, serratus anterior and external oblique muscles. The apex of the mammary gland is directed forward, it is pointed, and the one extension from the upper lateral quadrant, that is the axillary tail of Spence. Now what is the structure of the mammary gland? It consists of skin, parenchyma and the stroma. So structure is divided into three parts: the skin, parenchyma and the stroma. The skin of the gland, the parenchyma of the gland, the parenchyma forms the lobes and alveoli, and the stroma forms the fibrous septa and the fats. Now what is the arterial supply of the gland? The mammary gland is supplied by the internal thoracic artery. This is the internal thoracic artery, and it is a branch of subclavian artery. Then it is also supplied by the superior thoracic artery. This is superior thoracic artery. Then this is the thoracoacromial artery, and this is the lateral thoracic artery. These three, superior thoracic, thoracoacromial and lateral thoracic, these are the branches of axillary artery. And the third artery is the posterior intercostal arteries. These are the posterior intercostal arteries which supply the lateral part of the mammary gland. So it is highly vascular. The mammary gland is highly vascular, supplied by many arteries: the internal thoracic artery, which is a branch of subclavian artery, then superior thoracic, thoracoacromial and lateral thoracic, these are the branches of the axillary artery, and the posterior intercostal arteries, these are the branches of the thoracic aorta. Then veins follow the arteries, and there are two sets of veins, the superficial veins and the deep veins. Now superficial veins, they drain into the internal thoracic and superficial veins of the lower neck, and the deep veins drain into the axillary and posterior intercostal veins. So basically the veins, they follow the arteries, they run along with the arteries, but they are divided into two sets, the superficial set and the deep set. The superficial set drains into the internal thoracic vein and the superficial veins of the lower part of the neck, and the deep veins drain into the axillary and posterior intercostal veins. Now supply of the mammary gland. It is supplied by the anterior and lateral cutaneous branches of 4th to 6th intercostal nerves. Now the these nerve fibers are sensory to the skin, and autonomic, they convey the autonomic fibers to the smooth muscles and blood vessels. And the next is the lymphatic drainage. The lymphatic drainage of the mammary gland is the most important part of the mammary gland. Now, lymphatic drainage is divided into two parts, the lymphatic vessels and lymph nodes. Now, lymphatic vessels, again, lymphatic vessels are divided into superficial set and the deep set. Now, superficial set of the lymphatics drain the skin of the mammary gland except nipple and areola. So, the superficial set of lymphatics drain the skin of the mammary gland except the nipple and areola, and these superficial lymphatics drain into the adjacent lymph nodes. So, in the vicinity of the mammary gland, there are various lymph nodes like axillary lymph nodes, internal mammary lymph nodes, supraclavicular lymph nodes. So, superficial lymphatics drain into the adjacent lymph nodes, while the deep lymphatics drain the parenchyma of the mammary gland along with the nipple and areola. So, deep lymphatics drain the parenchyma of the mammary gland along with the nipple and areola, and they also drain into the adjacent lymph nodes. So, lymphatic vessels are divided into superficial set and the deep set. Now, which are the lymph nodes present close to the mammary gland? These are the axillary lymph nodes. The axillary lymph nodes are the most important lymph nodes in case of the mammary gland. So, these are the axillary lymph nodes which are present in the axilla, and there are five sets of axillary lymph nodes. This is the anterior, this is the posterior, these are the lateral lymph nodes, this is the central, and these are the apical lymph nodes. So, there are five sets of axillary lymph nodes. They are present in the axilla. Then, internal mammary. These are the internal mammary lymph nodes which are present along with the internal mammary vessels. Then, the supraclavicular lymph nodes. These are the supraclavicular lymph nodes which are present above the clavicle. Cephalic lymph nodes are present along with the cephalic vein. Then the posterior intercostal lymph nodes are present along with the posterior intercostal vessels. Then in addition to that, there are minute lymph nodes like subdiaphragmatic lymph nodes and subperitoneal lymph nodes. So there are many lymph nodes close to the mammary gland, in relation to the mammary gland. So axillary lymph nodes, internal mammary lymph nodes, supraclavicular lymph nodes, cephalic lymph nodes, posterior intercostal lymph nodes, subdiaphragmatic and subperitoneal lymph nodes. Axillary lymph nodes are the most commonly drainage area. Now, why lymphatic drainage is important in case of mammary gland? Because the carcinoma of the mammary gland spread via the lymphatic vessels and lymph nodes. So, lymphatic drainage is very, very important in case of the mammary gland. Now, clinical anatomy of the mammary gland. These are some developmental defects. In some cases, there are accessory nipples are found, and this accessory nipple is called as polythelia. Sometimes there is absence of nipple, which is called as athelia. Then there is accessory breast. In some cases you can find accessory breast, that is called as polymastia. Then absence of breast is called as amastia. Now, what is gynecomastia? Gynecomastia, it is a development of breast in males, and this is due to the hormones, some drugs, and or due to some chromosomal anomalies. Like for example, in Klinefelter syndrome, You can see the gynecomastia. There is enlarged breast in males. Next condition is the fibroadenosis. This is seen in females. There is pain and tenderness in the breast tissue due to increased vascularity during secretory phase of menstrual cycle. Another condition is fibroadenoma. It is a benign tumor. It is benign tumor in the breast, and it is well-defined lump. Lump means swelling. It is a well-defined lump in the breast which moves under palpating hand. And next is the abscess, which is abscess means there is an infection in one or more lobules of the gland. Lastly, the carcinoma of the breast. This is the commonest cancer in the females. And what are the clinical features? So carcinoma is characterized by the lump in the breast. Lump means swelling in the breast. Then there is a retraction of the skin. There is a retraction of the nipple. Then there is edema, pitting edema of the breast, and this pitting edema is called as the powdery orange. Then the lymph nodes, axillary lymph nodes, become hard and fixed. There is fixation of the breast to the deep fascia or pectoral fascia. And the carcinoma may spread to the opposite breast or to the liver, lungs, bone and ovary. So this is all about the pectoral region and the mammary gland. Thank you.